Well, hello world, it's Terry Marshall again. Listen, when Sony told me I could come and do this interview, they said you're going to enjoy meeting Melanie Doane because she's very bright, she's very talented, and also she is extremely beautiful. Well, I can't argue with any of that, and I was very happy about it until I got Melanie's CD. And then I read the lyrics to one of her songs, which said that you cannot have the beautiful without the ugly. So now that I've established my role in this interview, let's get round and talk to Melanie. I looked at your electronic press kit over the weekend, and the overall impression I came away above all others was the fact that you're in a very happy place right now, that you know it, and that you're extremely grateful. How close am I?
You're absolutely right. That's exactly how I feel.
Well, talk a little bit about how it's all come about. How did you go from being a relative unknown to being an overnight success after 10 years of hard work?
Well, I think I'm still working away from the unknown, but I've just been working hard. I've been doing a lot of playing and a lot of touring and a lot of writing, and this record is the result of all of that. And
this record,
yeah.
We'll do a little close-up so everybody sees what that is. It must have been a work of love for you, very obviously, but I would have thought also very, very intimidating. What was the catalyst? How did it get started, this particular record?
Do you mean intimidating because I went away to do it, or I'm just
Well, intimidating
curious?
Because you look at all the competition there is out there. I mean, the fact that you're setting out, here you are, as I say, relatively unknown at a point. Mm-hmm. You're deciding you're going to write all the words, all the music, and produce and sing it all, play half the instruments on it. Mm-hmm. That's a pretty daunting undertaking for anybody.
I guess I don't think about that, actually. The work comes from a place in me that is I have a need to do it. I have a need to express myself, and I have a need to sing and play, and all of that has nothing to do with anyone else. So that's really how I have to look at it. As far as the creation of this particular work, it involved taking myself to a place where I would be willing to take more risks, and I did that. I went away. I thought you might be referring to that, but I went to Los Angeles to work with a new writer and maybe to see if we could collaborate a little bit. And as a result of that trip, I went down and ended up staying until the record was finished. We wrote five songs together, my lyrics, but our musical collaboration, songs that those are the vocals that you hear on the record are what we did in that first week of meeting each other. I mean, it was an amazing kind of situation that I don't think happens very often, where you meet this person who is obviously your partner in crime, you know, and it's a wonderful thing. And
we should name him. It's Rick Nair,
yes,
right?
Rick Nair is his name, and that was a real big piece of the puzzle that had been missing, I think. Along with the fact that I needed to do a lot of work in order to get to the place where I was ready to meet him, you know.
What made you pick Los Angeles?
It wasn't really even about Los Angeles, it was about Rick and the fact that he approached me, had heard my last record and had heard that I might be writing or preparing to make a new record, and made the calls and said, you know, I'd really love to work with you, I'd love to just try this out, I really feel like we might click, and why don't you come down to Los Angeles. So if he had said Boston or, you know, Truro, Nova Scotia, I think I would have gone, because it was something that I just felt that if he had heard my voice and was that interested, that I really should take the time to check him out, and it was the best thing I ever did.
I want to come back to Adam's Rib and the music in a minute, but you mentioned Truro, Nova Scotia, which is a good point to depart, mm-hmm. because we know where you're coming from now, but where did you come from originally? I know it's back east.
Yeah, I was born in Truro, grew up in Halifax, and I've lived in Toronto now for almost 10 years, so I'm a Maritimer, but someone who's been in the city for a while, and I guess that has an interesting perspective in some ways, just because of... I always think it's great to come from a smaller place. When you grow up in Halifax, you don't know how small the place is. You think it's a big city until you go to Toronto, and then you realize, oh my gosh, this is a big city. And then you go to New York, and you're always growing and changing. But I think it's great if you're from a smaller place originally, you end up going everywhere. You end up having to go places in order to just, for your job, for your education, for whatever reasons, you end up traveling and seeing more than I think if you're actually from a bigger center. And I've really seen that as an advantage my whole life, and I think it's an advantage as a songwriter.
You have made reference in your press kit to the fact that you are influenced. Well, actually, it's interesting because the main influence of Nova Scotia seems to come about when you actually left. But listening to your music initially, one would not necessarily, apart from Mel's Rock Pile, detect that Celtic influence. And yet, I would imagine that unless you were totally sacrilegious, when you first started out, you must have started out playing Celtic music.
Along with a lot of other things. I guess I have a problem with anyone sort of putting me in any kind of category, and I think the way I grew up, my dad's a music teacher, and we grew up playing music in the home just for fun all the time, and there was a real East Coast kind of connection, somewhat Celtic music, a lot of Don Messer, which was a little more on the swinging side of fiddle music. My dad loved big band and barbershop music and Dixieland music and all of that kind of stuff that I learned to love as a little kid, and all of those experiences are part of what I do. I had classical background, but that's not what I do now. And I've again, coming back to this record, for the first time I think I've realized a sound that is me, that incorporates all of those things that I grew up on and that I love, and it's not confusing. I think in the past there might have been confusion. Oh, we think she's Celtic, we think she's country, we think she's folk, what is she? And I'd always be thinking to myself, why don't they get, I've got this original sound, why aren't people getting it? And again, it comes back to being very clear and taking the chances to, that extra mile to communicate it, you know, lyrically and vocally and instrumentally, but and also having this great producer help you mold the shape and sound of it.
Now, you've actually answered the question I was going to ask, and so I will ask it now, and I want to come back to something I was about to ask you. But you said in your press kit you were very happy, you've reached the watershed in as much as you have actually, you think, discovered your voice. I was going to say to you, when you say your voice, do you mean the sound of the band and the structure of the music, or do you mean literally your vocal delivery, or do you mean really what it is you're going to say, or is it maybe all three?
I think it's all of those things. I mean, my voice, meaning almost my vision, and taking a dream from a place that's in your mind that you don't tell anyone, to a place where you dare to say it out loud, to a place where you're actually doing it. And to find your voice, I guess I'm thinking of it in a metaphorical way, that you know, to actually be saying and doing and feeling all of the things that I've been wanting to do. That's the place I feel like I'm at now.
Yes, that does make sense, and I sort of got that, which is why I said you'd almost answered the question I was about to ask. So let's go back to the question I was going to ask, which is essentially this, that you're a disgustingly talented person. I mean, I don't know how many instruments you play, and I will find out in a minute, but what did you start off with? What was the first instrument you picked up?
I was actually fighting with my mom about this, because I've been under the impression that I played ukulele first, and she thinks I played violin first. She may be getting the kids mixed up, though. I don't know. I could accuse her of that, but I guess I have an elder sister who's 4 years older, and she was playing, I always remember her always playing violin and piano and ukulele and whatever else seemed to be around, and my dad plays everything, so.
And you've got two brothers?
One brother. Who's in my band and plays drums. So I remember being more proficient on the ukulele and singing and playing. I did start violin lessons around 3, though, so it's kind of hazy for me to actually tell you what's going on there.
Can you answer the other question? Is how many instruments, because you say somewhere you can play anything that's got strings to it, and I wonder if that included the harp and the hammered dulcimer.
No, I wouldn't say so. You know, that's a cheeky thing to say, but violin is my main instrument, and I guess because I've had good access to a lot of string instruments at home and growing up, I ended up getting stuck with the bass a lot because my brother was a really good drummer and my sister played piano, and my dad would come home and we'd jam and he'd say, get the bass. And I'd be like, I don't want to play the bass. Get the bass. So I learned how to play stand-up bass just by, you know, jamming at home, and then played electric bass as well, and took some of my ukulele skills into guitar skills. So I write on guitar a lot now, and I love to play live in my shows. Mandolin is same tuning as a violin, so I've been able to transfer some of my picking skills from my ukulele into mandolin, which I love to play. And
actually, ukulele is sort of making a little bit of a comeback, and I think your father makes them, doesn't he?
Well, he does. He makes a triangular shaped ukulele, and he used the ukulele in the schools. He was a supervisor of music for Halifax schools, and one of the ways, similar to the way they would use a recorder in schools, he came up with a method for ukulele, which was actually way more fun and way more musically sound, in that you could sing and play and read and play rhythm, harmony, and melody all with one instrument and accompany yourself. And it's very great, because we grew up being in groups where we used that, and it was a lot of fun.
I noticed that you certainly honor the old adage of writing about what you know, because what you seem to know best is yourself, as mm-hmm. most people do. What a crazy mixed-up kid you are. You've got, you're fighting between sort of matrimony, between poetry and pregnancy, and between music and matrimony and all the rest of the things. Is it going to settle down? This sounds like it's a real battle for you to decide where you want to go next.
Well, I don't think it's going to settle down. I think that's just part of what it is, and I think I'm speaking for more than just myself a lot of times here. The inspiration comes from something that I'm feeling and living through, but I really try to address it in a way that people will listen to the song and they'll hear themselves. I'd love it if they hear themselves and not so much me. You know, I think it's great if they like what I do, but really I'm hoping to connect with people and have them respond at a level that is resonating in their bones. You know. I don't know, as far as, The Happy Homemaker, I think, is something you're referring to, which is one of the songs. And
well, I did wonder if your biological clock was actually ticking that loudly.
Well, it is, and it's something that I just feel a lot of confusion about, it as to how I'm going to deal with having children. And it even goes further than just the child, raising children issue, but also this whole striving to find a place in the world and not necessarily having role models that are going to be able to show us new ways, especially as a woman. I think we're experiencing that. We love our mothers and we adore our mothers, but we don't necessarily want to do what our mothers did. And I think that's a really hard thing, because then we're looking towards who to guide us. And in the song, I guess I'm referring to, I say barefoot and pregnant never looked so good, and it never looks so good because we can't go back to what that was, and of course that's, take it all with a grain of salt. But I'm trying to raise a few shackles, and really I think the main issue is, as women and men, that we do what we are meant to do and what we are passionate about and what makes us fulfilled, whether it's staying home and raising our kids, whether you're the man or the woman, whether you feel you have a driving need to be out in the world and scratching and clawing your way. I mean, I felt that way. I felt that I'm scratching and clawing. Why am I doing this? Why am I putting myself through this? Why don't I just stay home and enjoy life? But then being totally afraid of what that might mean for me, and if I could actually be satisfied, and would I just then be tearing up my hair thinking, why am I not? I could have had a career, And I think we're all dealing with that, whether we're a man or a woman. My experience is as a woman, so I look at it from that point of view, and that's kind of where the song is coming from. And I hope, you get a laugh as well as make you think a little bit.
Well, you touched on a couple of quick things there, one of which was, I bet your mum's not half proud of you, especially after you dedicated a very charming song to her on your CD, Adam's Rib.
Well, the Good Gift song is what you're referring to, right?
Right.
Yeah, okay.
The one you dedicated to your mum?
Yeah. Sorry. What's the question?
I said, your mum must be very proud of you at this point, I would think, especially being sort of not now known just in Truro or South Maitland, but probably around the world now.
She's proud. I think the neat thing I find when I talk to my mom about the music I'm making and the songs that I'm writing, she says to me, how did you know I'm thinking that? And I'm like, Mom, I'm thinking that. Don't you see? That's me. And she says, but somehow you're picking up on what I've been going through, when you were a kid and things I was living through. And I'm saying, no, Mom, it's not about that. But I obviously was tuning into something. And, again, back with the Happy Homemaker thing, I say we're scared to be our mothers and we're scared of going soft, which is, we've got this, we have to succeed. We have to break all these patterns. We have to be strong women who do everything and have it all. And, it's crap. It's not real. Anyway.
Here's an off-the-wall question. You were up at the Millennium Club, I was looking around the audience, and I don't think there was a straight male in the audience that wasn't just a little bit of lust in with you that evening. And then I just sort of I read that you have to write intense love songs to your television. Are you kidding me? I come to the conclusion that TV must be the man in your life.
Well, sometimes the TV is the man in my life. That's the sad reality of it.
I thought it might be the initials of the man in your life.
TV. Close, but not quite. No, I mean, that's a song. I've had more than my fair share of lonely nights watching TV. And again, there's a deeper level to that song where I think, you know, TV is replacing a lot of things in our life and a lot
too many
community. You know, we don't have a sense of community. So I feel good when I turn on the TV and I know other people are watching the hockey game. It makes me feel close to someone, even though I'm alone in my house. It's crazy. I mean,
I have a suggestion. Turn on the internet. You'll like to find interesting people like us.
I'm so addicted. I love the internet. I love it.
Well, Melanie, as I anticipated, it was a real joy to sit down and chat with you. They were absolutely right, bright, talented, and beautiful.
Thank you very much.
And next time you're back in Vancouver, we'll do this again.
I'd love to.